We're going to get started. So thank you all for coming to this very special event. I think it really sort of started at the Peyton Fest when Ed mentioned that this was his 50th year in Peyton Hall. I thought, wow, that's quite a milestone and something that couldn't be missed. And most importantly, I thought, well, Ed must have this tremendous knowledge of what's been going on here that many of us, including myself, may not quite be aware of the early years of the history of Peyton Hall. And so Ed has graciously agreed to give us a talk on the early years of Peyton Hall, especially the first decade. And I'm really looking forward to that. So Ed, please.
Thank you.
Well, I'm going to start this talk off with a quiz. What is it about this picture that looks a little unusual?
No fine hall.
Mary Lewis Library.
There we go.
That's the chair.
Impressive. The way things look. Well, there's been a substantial change over the years. In this talk, I want to avoid to be tedious and boring and really just tell you stories about life, about people, and about events. And I'm not going to go through a long history of the department up to the present time. It would take too long, it would probably put you to sleep. There is a little bit of a selection bias in my talk. Since I'm an observer, I'll probably be telling you more about the observational side of the department rather than the theory side, even though our department in the early days really emphasized theory. Okay, let's start with what happened before Peyton Hall. And in the late 1950s, the department was housed in the Observatorium of Instruction on Prospect Street near Washington Road. And this served as the Department of Astronomy. And it also had the living quarters of the department chair. Well, in the late 1950s, early 60s, the university decided about it had to build a new building. You see under the red arrow there, that's where the observatory was. And the Princeton hired the architect Yamasaki to build a brand new building for the Woodrow Wilson School. Yamasaki said, yes, I can build this wonderful building, but location is important. And I want it to be right here. Now, that's a problem. But he insisted. And the university said, well, okay, we'll have to do something about that. First thing we'll do is that we will demolish the observatory and then we'll take the other building and we'll move it back. That's exactly what they did. This large building, which is now Martin Hall, was moved on rails. Took a long time to set up the rails, and they moved this whole thing in about a day. So now the present day situation, Corwin Hall is there in that upper thing, picture. And in the lower picture are Fisher and Blenheim Halls, which were built in 1991 as additions. Robertson Hall is the current Woodrow Wilson School location. Now here's a picture of the campus as it was in the 1950s. The Observatory for Instruction was there on 14 Prospect Street, all right? It went away, so the department had to move down to a small cinder block building on Fitz Randolph Road, and it was in that location until 1966 when Peyton Hall was built. We moved into Peyton Hall in the late 1966. That's what it looked like at that time, and the reason it was called Peyton Hall, usually you name a building after somebody who contributes money towards this establishment. It was Bernie Peyton. He was the one that donated a large sum of money, and that plus money from some government agencies was used to pay for the building of the hall. Mr. Yamasaki also designed Peyton Hall. If you look at the Wikipedia page on Yamasaki and look at a long list of buildings that he built, Peyton Hall is not in that list. But let me show you other buildings he did build, and you'll notice some commonality in the style. I guess architects would call it neo-Gothic. I think it's inspired by diffraction gratings. But we have the World Trade Center, the Woodrow Wilson School, and the Conservatory of Music at Oberlin College. So that was his way of designing buildings. But Yamasaki's buildings were not all successful. His firm designed the Pruitt-Igoe buildings that were later demolished. It was low-income housing. I think it was in St. Louis. Now, life back in 1966 was a little different than now. The town of Princeton had very few restaurants.
Wait, I thought you said it's different. Sorry.
But it was a much smaller selection. Also, the university did not admit women. They were not admitted until 1969, except the critters. Not those kind of critters. Critters were women who were students who majored in what were called critical languages that were not offered at other universities. So Princeton made an exception and admitted women before 1969 if they were majoring in critical languages. Now, Peyton Hall was a bit different than it was now. There was a major refurbishment of Peyton Hall in 2008. And before that time, we had a very leaky roof, and occasionally the basement would flood. Also, room 106 in the corner here was a conference room, not a suite of offices. And it got very cold in the winters during the oil crisis. The university throttled back on heating. Got so cold that you could store milk and cheese in it for a long time. We had no elevator. They didn't need an elevator back then. We do now. We had a dark room. Back in those days, we used photographic films for various purposes. That is now a storage room for the janitors. And the basement area was much more open than it is now. It had large open space for data reduction and storing of plots for the Copernicus project. It had more lab space. So it was a very different configuration then. But then there was pressure to have more offices. So those areas were converted into offices. But most important was that Peyton Hall had its own library inside. The library was located where the Grand Central is. It's larger than Grand Central. The offices around Grand Central were originally a part of the library. And this was important, and it was something that was really, Lyman Spitzer thought this was crucial, to have an astronomy library in the building, so you didn't have to walk across the campus to get to your journals. And that was during the day that you didn't have electronic journals. So you had to go to a library or to somebody's office, somebody who subscribed to a paper version of the journal, or your own collection to look at the references. I've been at universities where the library, the great central library, had all the astronomy stuff. And at even one university I went to, Tübingen, the library was across town, so this was a wonderful convenience. As for people, the two dominant personalities in the department at that time were Lyman Spitzer and Martin Schwarzschild. They came to Princeton at about the same time, 1947, and in addition to these people, we had a small staff of faculty and researchers and one engineer. Of course, there were a lot of other people, but these are the people who sort of stayed around for a while. Rich Gott, you were a graduate student there, so you came later and you stayed a long time. Russell, is he here? I guess not. Russell Culsrud, who you see occasionally. I was hoping he'd be here to be my fact checker, as he has a long memory of what the department was like. Let me now go into departmental traditions. How things were back then. We had no morning coffee. In fact, I think once they even sent out a questionnaire, would you be interested in having coffee in some location? And most people said no. It was not until 1991 that Frank Vertovin, who was a postdoc here, was astonished that we didn't have any sort of European-style coffee gathering. So he started the coffee tradition, where people just came in and had coffee and just talked informally. We didn't have the archive at that point. The funny thing about it is that Frank never went to the coffee. He established it, and he never showed up. But eventually, this coffee hour evolved into the now the Astro Coffee we have, now that we have the archive that we can access and discuss the latest developments.
This is because Frank didn't like to get up before noon.
Yeah.
He preferred the coffee before noon.
Right, yeah.
That's
right.
That's really important.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes, exactly. The other departmental tradition was Tuesday lunch, but not with John McCall. This was with Ben Strongman. He was the equivalent of John McCall back then. And we had lunch in a small conference room in the top floor of Fold Hall, where I have that red arrow. And there was a small cafeteria there. So we got our lunch in the cafeteria right up there, and then had our Tuesday lunches in this conference room at that location. The present location of the cafeteria, that hadn't been built at that time. The other departmental tradition was ordinary lunches, which we actually had the entire department would come, or at least everybody who was interested in having lunch. We'd all go over to the New South Building, and they had a cafeteria on the seventh floor, and we ate there. We had nice windows looking out onto the campus. It was the best view of the campus because you didn't have to look at this New South Building. essentially the same as what we have now, except that one event we had was the final of the ping pong tournament, and that seems to no longer exist. For the annual meetings of the advisory committee, it was far more restricted than now. It only included the senior faculty. It was very formal. You knew when this was happening because you'd see the senior faculty coming as if they were dressed going to a funeral. And then they had the reception later in the Peyton Mansion, because Bernie Peyton was the chair of the advisory committee at that time. So it was a very exclusive affair, nothing like the much more open affairs that we have now once a year with the advisory committee. As for talks, colloquia were only held in the spring semester. The premise of that was that in the fall you really got things done, and then in the spring we relaxed and listened to colloquia. The spring lecture series we had back then was the same as the Spitzer lectures that we have now. And otherwise, since we had a small department, there were relatively few ad hoc lectures, people passing through, giving spontaneous lectures. We now have a far higher frequency of talks, and that's appropriate. We're a much bigger department. For the graduate program, most students finish their thesis in 3 years. I think there's been a gradual increase over the time. And back then, in the physical sciences, the general protocol was that you had to be able to read scientific literature in 2 out of the 3 languages, French, German, or Russian. Lyman would give the French exam, and Martin would give the German exam. I don't know who did the Russian exam. I'll tell you a funny story about me during the reception about one of the German exams that Martin gave. It was really pretty hilarious, but it takes too long now. When I got my PhD in 1966, I had to do this, and I found it rather annoying that they were beginning to relax these requirements. I think MIT allowed you to substitute Fortran for one of the research activities. I just looked back through the observatory reports, and these were sort of the main topics that were covered in 1996. So those were the topics. Things were different then, the way you did your daily business. We did have hardships. And when I talk about hardships, I mean hardships from our current way of thinking, our current way of doing things. Back then they were just considered normal and no problem. If you're writing paper, remember we don't have computers, we don't have desk computers, you would write the paper out in longhand or on your own typewriter. You'd give it to a secretary to type up. The secretary would type up the draft. You'd look at it, you'd correct the typos, and you'd make some changes here and there. And then you give it back to the secretary again. Well, then new typos would appear. So you have to read the paper all over again to find the new typos, and then it's sort of continual cycle.
But there's no exit from that.
Eventually something would happen.
You also left out
some paper.
Boxes right in the equation.
Yes, that's right, right in by hand, the equation. Now, we didn't have archive. Preprint, you took the finished copy of the paper and you take it over to New South Building where they had a printing operation, and they print up 50 copies for you, and you put covers on them, and then you mail them out to people. So these things would collect on people's desks. It was a very antiquated system by our present standards. The other hardships of the time were giving presentations. We had no PowerPoint, we had no view graphs. All you had if you wanted to show something was a 3x5 glass slide. And that was the standard mode of presentation at meetings in those days. So you go through this tedious process of making your plot by hand. You have a guy make a nice ink drawing, and they'd photograph it, and then they'd make a glass slide. And, you know, you finally made a mistake, you start all over again. So it was a much slower business. Another hardship of the time is that you used a slide rule. Did you ever see one of these? I have a sample here. This is actually, I got this from Bruce. This is Lyman's slide rule. This is the same slide rule as that one. That's how you did the computations. We phased out the slide rule at about the time that Hewlett-Packard produced hand calculators that could do logarithms, sines and cosines, all sorts of exponentiation, taking roots. It was a wonderful advance, but before then, you were dependent upon the slide rule.
You're the one who introduced that.
Yes, that's right, HB65. It cost $600. That's a lot of money back then. Another hardship of the time is the way you talk to computers. And if some of you want to look at this, have some samples. Okay.
To be fair, someone had printed a stack of Fortran code on the printer earlier today, so that still happens. Not punch cards, right. But Fortran code.
I see. Fortran, yes. Does anybody recognize this?
Right.
That's right. It's the right protect ring that you put on a 7 or 9 card tape. So tapes, or we used to call them IBM cards, but they really should be called punch cards, were the way we talked to computers. And the way you created it was on one of these. This is the punch card machine. When Mark Schwarzschild was working on stellar evolution and interior, he had a colleague, Richard Harm, do all his computing. And so Martin would do all the physics and figure things out, and then he'd tell Richard to code the computer program to calculate the stellar interior or the stellar evolution. Well, Richard retired in about 1975. And so Martin no longer had him at his disposal. And moreover, the field had advanced to the point where he decided it was time to move on to something else. And in particular, he realized that others was now doing magnetic fields and stellar rotation, and his stellar interior models were getting a bit old-fashioned. So he decided to switch fields. This is rather late in his career. He decided to go into stellar dynamics in triaxial potentials. And he also decided he's got to learn to do his own computer program. So one day I was sitting at one of these machines doing my own punching, and there was another empty machine next to me. And Martin came down, it was in the basement, he came down, and here's the machine, you look at it, and then he sat down. He looked at the keyboard. He said, "Goodness gracious, they're not in alphabetical order." He didn't have to interact with typewriters because he had a secretary type all this stuff. So, you know, the real world was confronted. Okay, well, then you punch your cards, and then you had to take them up to the computer center. And this is a good chance for you to get out of your office and get some fresh air and go for a walk. So the computer center is up there at the top, and so you carry your deck of cards up. And usually, you know, you'd have a rubber band around. Well, if the rubber band was a little too old and it broke, and then, you know, you have to pick it all up and redo your program, figure out what line came after which. And that made life a little difficult. Let me talk now about observational facilities. We didn't have much. We had access, no really other than, you know, public access to any large aperture ground-based telescopes. We were completely we just couldn't compete with the Western institutions that had mountains and good weather and good telescopes. We did, however, have a telescope down at the FitzRandolph Observatory, and that was a 36-inch reflecting telescope that replaced a large refractor that we had sold to the U.S. Naval Observatory. And this telescope was really used mainly for testing instrumentation or novel observing concepts, and doing very limited studies or something. We just couldn't compete with the big powers out west. This building also served as the office of the executive secretary of the American Astronomical Society, Paul Routley. Lyman had established this position. The university was willing to given the office rent-free to the AAS, and Paul served there for quite a while. He was later replaced by Hank Gurin, and then after that, the AAS decided that they really needed to have an office in Washington, D.C. so they could interact with the agencies and with other scientific societies. So they moved out of Princeton. But for quite some time, the real headquarters of the AAS for getting things done was in that office. Later on, that building was used for a guest living quarters for departmental visitors. For observations, we had the stratoscope program run by Martin Schwarzschild, Martin and Bob Danielson. I had a balloon borne telescope, which went up to about 24 kilometers to get above the ceiling. So the idea was to do high resolution photography of astronomical objects in a fashion that you couldn't do from the ground. And this is before we had adaptive optics on large telescopes. So it was the only way to get high resolution. And of course, this was well before the era of the Hubble Space Telescope. They observed, I'll show you the objects they observed. I looked at the paper for NGC 4151, and it all discusses a very dense stellar cluster as the source of the nucleus of NGC 4151, with no mention of a black hole, as far as I could tell. It was a sounding rocket program run by Don Morton, and I came to Princeton to work with him on sounding rockets. Of course, this picture here, this is a daytime shot. We actually only observed at night. So that shows you what a nighttime launch looks like. So you'd launch this thing at the White Sands Missile Range, and your observations would last for about 4 or 5 minutes, and then your payload would land up in the desert, and the next day you'd go in a helicopter to search for it and pick up the payload. Don Morton was a climbing enthusiast, a very serious mountain climber. He went on many expeditions, did a lot of really ambitious rock climbing. When he did his exercises getting ready for rock climbing, he did chin-ups. But he didn't go to the gym and use a chinning bar. He put his fingers on the quarter-inch molding of the door in his office and do chin-ups like that, with just a quarter-inch thing to hold on to. It's pretty remarkable. And that's the sort of thing you have to do when you're doing serious rock climbing, is to find some little tiny crevice and pull yourself up by your fingers. The other thing he did, he was so much of an enthusiast that sometimes we'd go out to a fancy restaurant. And if the restaurant had a decorative rock wall on the side, he'd say, "Oh, I think I could climb this." So he'd start climbing. The rest of us were kind of, we don't know this guy. Who's he? It's kind of embarrassing. But then on the sounding rocket flights, I and some graduate students had a mandatory extracurricular activity, which was to join him in this rock climbing. Mm-hmm. In fact, my wife Myrna even climbed stuff like this. So this is something we had to do. Fairly good climb. And to prove that I made it to the top, here's a picture I took of Don when we finally got up there. There's another climbing enthusiast in the department, that's Lyman Spitzer. And he went on some expeditions with Don Morton. But the one that we all remember most is the climbing of the Graduate College of Tallinn. Now, they didn't climb on the stairs on the inside, they climbed on the outside. Well, they started at about 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning. And they made the mistake of making too much noise. I mean, there's this, up rope, en belay, climbing, and that woke somebody up, called the campus police. Campus police came out, told them to get off right away. And a few days later, Lyman got a letter of reprimand from the dean of the faculty. I think that was Aaron Lemonick. The letter of reprimand was a little tongue-in-cheek because he thought it was kind of funny. But he felt obliged that he had to tell the department chair that he had done something very naughty. Another observational enterprise, in a sense, was that our department was very much engaged in planning space telescopes of various types. And here's one depicted here. And they had Perkin Elmer's system in setting up the design of the telescope and of the camera system and everything. This involved some interaction with people at NASA. When they go down to one of the NASA centers and give a presentation, not only to NASA officials, but also to the astronauts who had to do EVAs to do any kind of surveying. And this was kind of a chance for everyone to learn from each other what are the limitations, what are the problems, how to get things done. The astronauts would talk about the kind of handholds they have and the way, the only kind of things you could do in space if you're repairing anything or adding anything on. And after one of these meetings, they had a mock-up of one of the telescope systems on a table. And an astronaut came up, and he looked at it, and he looked around, and he said, "Where's the eyepiece?" I guess the common perception is that astronomers had telescopes and they always look through an eyepiece. So they had to explain, well, that's not quite the way we do it now. The other observation, and this was really a major project within the department in the 1970s, but something that started in the 1960s, was the Copernicus satellite. It was the third in a series of orbiting astronomical observatories that was set up by NASA. It was a UV spectrometer and telescope to look at absorption lines and stellar spectra in the ultraviolet. First chance we had to really get good high-resolution spectra of stars in the ultraviolet. The real hero of this project was Jack Rogerson. He was the executive director. Even though Lyman was the PI, got a lot of the credit, it was Jack Rogerson who really made it work, because he did the day-to-day management of the program. And I don't think he got enough recognition for it that he really deserved. He did a marvelous job. So we had this telescope. We launched it in 1972. And on the night of the launch, we were aware that there was a problem, and it's something we knew about for some time. During a thermal vacuum test, they found that the focus drive mechanism for the secondary mirror failed in thermal vacuum conditions. It would work in normal laboratory conditions. We were very nervous about this, that this would happen in orbit. And if we couldn't focus that secondary, it wouldn't work. We couldn't get light down the slit. So the night of the launch, Lyman said, "We've really got to try and set it to where we think it's the best focus, just in case that drive motor fails again in orbit." So that evening, in a motel room, he and the rest of us went about trying to determine what is the best location for the focus. After a lot of computations, which involved taking test data and making corrections and so forth, Lyman worked out what that optimal position was that evening of the launch. And it turned out that action saved the whole mission, because indeed we were in perfect focus when we got into orbit. We didn't have to move the focus drive. And later we did find out that indeed the focus drive had failed when we were doing the end of mission test. Now this story got around, but it got a little bit embellished. And I found out about that when in 1997, when Lyman died, about a few weeks afterwards, I got a call from John McCall. And he says, tell me about Lyman climbing the gantry tower, putting on his mountaineering stuff, getting his ropes, climbing that gantry, and making a last minute adjustment. I said, John, that didn't happen. Where did you hear? So, in fact, that last minute adjustment was made in the comfort of the control room at the launch site. Now, when you launch a satellite, you want to observe the most important thing you can think of first, just in case there's some catastrophic failure early in the mission. We know from the colloquium we heard just this week about the Hitomi failure, and they wisely look at the Perseus cluster, the brightest thing, they got a spectrum before they had a disaster. Well, we had that same thing in mind when we were running the Copernicus satellite. And the main objective of this satellite was to observe molecular hydrogen. So one of the earliest scans we had programmed was to look at the star most likely to show molecular hydrogen, which was Zeta O, because we knew from visual observations there were some molecules in that line of sight. It was a famous case. And we put the spectrograph, we centered it, and it's a scanning spectrograph. So it just can look at a very limited range. It's a photometer that just moves along in sequence. We centered that scan on the strongest line that we could think of for molecular hydrogen. This is what we got. Nothing. I mean, there's a continuum there. As far as you can see, there's just no absorption feature whatsoever. And this was very disturbing to Lyman. He predicted there'd be lots of molecular hydrogen, and there was nothing there. It wasn't until a couple of days later, when a low-resolution scan over a much broader wavelength range revealed that. And the little place in the box was where the high-resolution scan was taken. All he was seeing was just grating scatter. Another observational effort at the observatory was the development of a television image sensor that was sensitive and that could be suitable for some sort of a space observatory. And we had in mind the Hubble, what was called Space Telescope at that time, is now the Hubble Space Telescope. This was the SEC Vidicon. And this never flew. It was developed by Westinghouse under the supervision of Princeton. And the person in charge was John Lorenz, the engineer. But the basic idea is that you have light hitting a photocathode, the electrons would then be accelerated to a target, a very fluffy target that would produce many secondary electrons, and those would be read out by an electron beam. Now, it didn't fly on HST, but it was still important. It was not a complete failure because it convinced people that it was possible to do a recording electronically and not have to use film. And that was a major selling point for the Hubble Space Telescope, that indeed you could send a picture to the ground that was recorded electronically. Now, in addition, as part of this project, in a lot of the testing, we had to have a way of displaying pictures that were recorded in computer memory. And John was very shrewd. He managed to get a hold of a device called a color scanner, which takes a color picture and makes separation negatives for the printing industry, the color printing industry magazines, Life magazine or something like that. We got this device, it was like a great big thing. It filled a room, a small room. We called it the Green Machine. And it was essentially a scanner that made an 11 by 14, you get a big piece of film. It had very small pixels, so you can make a very high quality photographic representation of an image that you had in the computer. Now, the only other way to show images was to take a picture of a cathode ray tube screen, and that was not very good. But this thing was fantastic for producing very high quality pictures. Let me give you an example of what it did. Carl Hylas produced a publication of a survey of neutral hydrogen at high latitudes. And this is what he published. It looked about like that. The only way he could display it was using contour diagrams. Well, what kind of sense can you make out of that? We took his data, put it on a 7-track tape, fed it to the green machine, and this is, of course, a small section of the sky. And this is what we got. Yeah. Now you can really see the structures. And moreover, we did different colors to represent different velocities. So it was an enormous advance in being able to visualize astronomical data, two-dimensional astronomical data. Another spectacular way that this machine really got into the literature was the production of an image of the Shane and Bertrand galaxy couch. And I think this was done by Selmer, Severs, Rolf, and Peebles. This is the first pictorial representation of structure of galactics, of structure of galaxies. This was all encoded on those IBM punch cards. All of the data were put on punch cards. And then they then fed it into this machine, and this produced this picture. Now, you may remember I said something about the fact that, well, you know, it doesn't matter if we don't have a library here, because you can get everything down electronically. I went to the AJ article where this picture was shown on the version on the ADS system. And this is what I got. So if you wanted to see this, well, I got the other picture off the web, some section. But if you wanted to get that picture, you would now have to go to the recap, you'd have to order it for recap in our library system.
Or you could ask me for the data.
What? Oh, yeah. But I mean, if you just wanted to look at the picture and see something better than that, you'd have to get the original journal. Let me talk a little bit about Lyman Spitzer. He founded the Princeton Plasma Physics Laboratory because he had an idea. He really started off with an idea of how to do controlled fusion, accelerator. He took great pride in being on President Nixon's enemies list. That to him was a noble accomplishment.
What specifically did he do to get that honor?
He thinks it's because he gave a lot of money to the Democratic Party. That's his interpretation. But he considers it a badge of honor. He also left a legacy of decorum that lives to this day. And I can show it this way. He'd say, "Mr. Lupton, when we go to lunch at the Institute, we wear shoes." Well, Robert, at least compromised, he wears flip-flops. And to this day, you will see that Robert wears flip-flops when he goes to the Institute lunch, all lunch. And moreover, you know, he went there one time and he wore his shoes and then he sat down at the table and took his shoes off. And Lyman said, "And I mean all of us." Lyman also defined the Lyman limit, which is not the ionization potential of hydrogen, but the establishment of a cutoff of exactly 130 for the lunches on Tuesday.
What we're discovering, that can be leaky.
Yes, in fact, that happened this week. Here's a scoreboard for major proposals in connection with the Hubble Space Telescope. Lyman and John McCall made many trips to Washington to lobby Congress and explain to them the importance to astronomy of the Hubble Space Telescope. And that was a very important contribution that the two of them made that resulted in what we have now. He also had some defeats. One of them was that we had submitted a proposal for a wide-field camera on the Hubble Space Telescope. And we lost to the Caltech group. We were outgunned by gun, pardon my pun. Their proposal was the one that won. They beat us on that. He also had one other defeat, which was he submitted a proposal to have the Space Telescope Science Institute located at Princeton. Lost out to another group which proposed Baltimore, as you know. The plan was to have the institute located in an open field just south of the Springdale golf course. So it'd be sort of between the institute and our department. Martin Schwarzschild, another strong personality in our department, was a remarkably good person, very wise in any sort of political matters or matters of protocol or something. And any time you had a problem, a difficult situation to deal with, you could go to Martin and he would work out what seemed like a good solution to a difficult situation. Martin also took on students who were having difficulty making progress. He was always the default person that would take on a student that needed discipline, needed a rather strict timetable for getting accomplishments done. Martin also was very politically involved in various commissions and stuff, and he helped to rewrite, or maybe he did it completely himself, rewriting the AAS bylaws. Well, let me move on to one other personality. You recognize this guy? I mean the big one, not the little one. He was our new departmental chair starting in 1980. If you don't recognize him, maybe this is a little. But starting in that era, the department really got involved in observations. We have the Sloan Digital Sky Survey, which is a really crowning achievement. But our department, thanks much to Jim Gunn and Robert Lupton and others, we got a share in the Apache Point Observatory, so we had a large aperture telescope we could work with. And Jerry was very aggressive in developing increased computing power for the department so that we could do hydrodynamic simulations and really get in the forefront of theoretical computing. Well, I've now reached a point that's well beyond the first 10 years, so I think this is a good time to stop. Thank you.
Tell us the story of Terry Mathilsky's German exam.
Yes. Martin Schwarzschild was the German examiner, and Terry Mathilsky, graduate student, went for his first exam for reading German. He failed. He failed miserably. And so he had to really study hard and master at least getting some German so he could pass that exam. The second time he went to Martin, he was very nervous. And Martin sat him down. He says, okay, here you go. Translate this. Terry looked at it. God. What can't do it. Doesn't even look like German. Martin, very good. Do something in German. About Terry to loosen up. Any other questions?
You mentioned the 36-inch telescope. You didn't tell us where the mirror came from. how do we come to have an error for it?
Oh, that was a spare for stratoscope. It was a spare mirror for stratoscope, and they put it in the telescope. They'll put it in the telescope. It's 36 inches.
You mentioned the beginning of archive, and I don't know if it's known that Bogdan Paczynski was a co-author of the first paper on astro-pH.
Oh. That's
interesting. I don't remember
the other one. So 0001? Yeah, I wasn't aware of that. That's interesting.
Anyone else?
Hanna said Cipiran. I think so. Cipiran, I think, was called.
I'm sorry, you said what?
Cipiran.
So what were some of the observations done with the telescope, with the 36 inch?
There was some testing of the SEC. There was some testing of some cameras. We did a fair number of observations with the Fabry-Perot. And we had a collaboration with people in Wisconsin. And they brought a Fabry-Perot, and we looked at the EO sulfur cloud. We took pictures of M81 in H-alpha at different velocities. There was a project for some time to detect microsecond pulses from other civilizations. That was fairly late. There was a group in physics that put on a high-speed photometer in attempting to detect laser pulses from the
that was fairly recent. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That was fairly recent.
Yeah,
back
yeah.
In the,
that's right.
In the 70s, I did my thesis timing the credit pulsar.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Okay. And there are a number of postdoc or graduate student projects that made use of that telescope. We did have the major disadvantage that it was near the football stadium. Mm-hmm. And when they turned on those lights, the sky brightness would go way up.
Still have that problem.
Is the telescope gone now, or is it still?
Yes, it's now gone.
It's gone.
I think it was given to an amateur astronomer group. Yeah.
Yes.
We donated an amateur astronomer. So it's now gone. In fact, we don't really own that building anymore. I think
it's the locks have been changed.
How do you
know? I know where the telescope is. It's actually at a semi-private observatory in Colorado. I think it's Hutt Observatory. We donated it.
Oh, okay.
So it's in use.
Yeah.
I think we tried to give it to Paul, with it at Trenton.
Called Charles
Drury, but they had some negotiation, but they couldn't accept it in the end.
I think there were two. There was an extra one, and I think it was given to the Mira collaboration long ago. So
yes.
It's still busy California.
Yes, that's right. There was a Mira that was in what was called a Stratoport, which is the garage next to there. That was another spare Mira, and that went to the one in Monterey.
Yeah, Mira.
Yeah. So, that's right.
Well, we have a reception planned right after now, right next door in Grand Central. So let's thank Ed again and everyone.